بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وعباد الرحمن الذين يمشون على الأرض هونا وإذا خاطبهم الجاهلون قالوا سلاما. وقال تعالى: ولا تصعر خدك للناس ولا تمشي في الأرض مرحا، إن الله لا يحب كل مختال فخور. وقال النبي صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم: من تواضع لله رفعه الله، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. Honorable ulama ikram, respected brothers and elders, every human on the face of this earth, regardless of his color, creed or nationality, is the servant of Allah, be it the believer or be it the kafir. However, there are certain servants of Allah whom Allah has very passionately referred to as his beloved servants. By way of example, a father has four sons, but he refers to one of them, that is my son, that is my boy. It does not for a moment mean that the other sons are not his sons, but the one that has been obedient to him, that has been obliging to him, the father makes reference to that son, that is really the son that I love most, my beloved son. I'm very fond of this particular boy. Likewise, every human on the face of this earth is the servant of Allah, but Allah has made reference to certain servants as the beloved servants of Allah. And hence Allah told the devil, إِنَّ عِبَادِي لَيْسَ لَكَ عَلَيْهِمْ سُلْطَانَ. O shaitan, you will try and mislead and beguile, but there are some of my beloved servants, you will try your level best, you will never succeed. نِعْمَ الْعَبْدُ إِنَّهُ أَوَّابٌ. What a brilliant servant Ayyub alayhi salam was. نِعْمَ الْعَبْدُ. What a brilliant servant Sulaiman alayhi salam was. قُلْنِ عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا يُقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةِ. Tell my beloved servants. The question arises, who are the beloved servants of Allah? In the 19th juz of the Quran, very explicitly, Allah highlights 13 qualities, 13 attributes of those people who are the beloved servants of Allah. The first of which is in the ayat al-karimah that I recited before you. وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنَا. Allah says, my choices, my beloved servants are those who walk on this earth with total humility. The first quality that defines one becoming the beloved of Allah is the quality of humility. Now when we say walking with humbleness, it does not for a moment suggest or advocate a slow walk, a lethargic walk. That is not a humble walk. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu seen one person walking very slowly. He asked him, are you sick? He said, no. Umar radiallahu anhu hit him one and said, walk fast. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam had a brisk walk. He had an upright walk. I haven't taken out time to study the walk of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. And amongst the daughters of Nabi alayhi salam, Sayyidatina Fatima radiallahu anha enjoys the privilege of emulating the walk of Nabi alayhi salam precisely. Sahaba used to say, if you've seen Fatima radiallahu anha walking from the back, you would swear this is the walk of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. What was the description of the walk of my Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Ka'annahu yanzil, as though he was descending from a flight of stairs. An upright walk, a brisk walk. However, Sahaba aired this description as though the Nabi of Allah was descending from a flight of stairs. So it was just not the walk of Nabi alayhi salam that denoted humbleness, but the entire life of Nabi alayhi salam was an embodiment of total humbleness. He was sitting in the house of Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu anha in an absolute humble posture. وَبَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ طَبَقْ. And he had a platter of food before him. He was eating from that platter of food, sitting on the floor. One woman happens to pass by. She glances at the humble posture of Nabi alayhi salam. She says, "Unduru ilayhi yajlisu kama yajlisu al-abd." Is this the man who they say is the noblest of humanity? But he sits like a slave. He sits like a slave. Nabi alayhi salam said, call that woman and tell her, yes, I am a slave. Ana ajlisu kama yajlisu al-abd. I sit like how a slave sits. Ana akulu kama ya'kulu al-abd. I eat like how a slave eats. أَنَا لَا أَكُلُ مُتَّكِئًا. I will never recline or lean against something and eat. أَنَا أَكُلُ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ. I sit on the floor and eat. أنا أجيب دعوة المملوك. I accept the invitation of beggars and slaves. لو دعيت إلى كراء لا أجبت. If you call me for a meager meal in which you've prepared nothing other than the shoulder of a sheep, I will accept your dawat. If you give me a meager gift, I will accept it. I have no fuss. These are the words of Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was sitting with his sahaba. One woman came. She was captured by the awe-striking personality of Nabi alayhi salam. She started pulsating and breathing heavily. Nabi alayhi salam said, "Hawwin alayk." Oh sister, calm down. فَإِنَّمَا لَسْتُ بِمَلِكٍ. Number one, I'm not a king. And then see how the Nabi of Allah introduces himself. And just not Allahu Akbar. Nabi alayhi salam says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ نَذَرَ فِي قُلُوبِ الْعِبَادِ. Allah searched the hearts of humanity. And Allah then selected my heart from the entire creation. فَبَعَثَ اللَّهُ بِرِسَالَتِهِ وَانْتَخَبَهُ بِعِلْمِهِ. And when Allah was to crown me, what prophet would Allah send? Jibreel. And Allah said, Jibreel, make one request to my Nabi. I'll give him one option in the matter. I have decided he is my Nabi. But I give him one choice. Either he accepts prophethood with the kingdom, with the dominion, or kingdom with slavery. One of the two choices. فَأَوْمَأَ إِلَيَّ جِبْرِيلِ. Nabi alayhi salam says, then Jibreel indicated to me, تَوَاضَعْ لِرَبِّكْ. Oh Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's your choice. Allah will respect your choice. But my humble opinion is display humbleness to your Lord. Nabi alayhi salam said, yes Jibreel, that is the very thing I was going to say. بَلْ نَبِيًا عَبْدًا بَلْ نَبِيًا عَبْدًا. I want prophethood with a slave, with slavery. I will live as a prophet and a slave. That is why the Nabi of Allah said, لَا تَرْفَعُونِي فَوْقَ قَدْرِي. O my Sahaba, do not elevate me beyond my position. فَتَقُولُوا فِيَّ مَا قَالَتِ النَّصَارَى فِي الْمَسِيحِ. And do not utter in my favor and my honor things which people said regarding Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. لَا تُفَضِّلُونِي عَلَى يُونَسُ بْدُمَتَّى. Do not constantly chant the slogans that I am nobler than Yunus. Although Allah has made me nobler than Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ اتَّخَذَنِي عَبْدًا قَبْلَ أَن يَتَّخَذَنِي رَسُولًا. For verily Allah has first made me his servant and then he has made me his prophet. Nabi alayhi salam told this woman, calm down. Then the Nabi of Allah introduces himself. He says, oh sister, let me tell you, I am an ordinary man. فَإِنَّمَا أَنَا ابْنُ إِمْرَأَةٍ مِّن قُرَيْشٍ تَأْكُلُ الْقَدِيرِ. I am an ordinary man of a simple woman from the Quraysh, and my mother used to live eating on dry meat. What did the Nabi of Allah describe himself by? I am an ordinary man of a simple... Can we call the mother of Nabi alayhi salam an ordinary mother? There hasn't been a greater woman on the face of this earth. Like Hassan ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu said, scholars write, nobody has praised Nabi alayhi salam in a more comprehensive description other than what Hassan ibn Thabit said. أَحْسَنَ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَرَقَتْتُ عَيْنِي. Oh my Nabi, more beloved than you, more handsome than you, I haven't seen. أَجْمَلَ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَلِدِ النِّسَاءُ. More beautiful than you, no woman has given birth to any child. خُلِقْتَ مُبَرَّأً مِنْ كُلِّ عَيْبِ. Allah has created you flawless and faultless. كَأَنَّكَ قَدْ خُلِقْتَ كَمَا تَشَاءُ. It is as if Allah created you and Allah fashioned you in the manner you wanted. So what did the Nabi of Allah say? I'm an ordinary person. Sahaba came to Nabi alayhi salam. O Nabi of Allah, often we present in the courts of kings and rulers and emperors, and we find that the people come bow as a token of respect. We find that you are most deserving for this respect. Permit us, when we make our presence, we can also have a bowing posture before you and then sit down in your gathering. Nabi alayhi salam said, هَذَا تَفْعَلُهُ الْأَعَاجِمُ بِمُلُوكِهَا. This is how the disbelievers honor their kings. Oh my Sahaba, to start off, I'm not a king. Nabi alayhi salam heard the Sahaba discussing. And someone said, so strange. Allah made Ibrahim his friend. From his creation, Allah made a friend. And Allah spoke to Musa. And Allah made Isa Ruhullah. Nabi alayhi salam overheard the discussion. He then came out. He said, oh my Sahaba, you were discussing. I heard this. You are correct in what you said. Inna Ibrahim Khalilullah. Ibrahim is the friend of Allah, as you said. Wa Musa Kalimullah. And Allah had communicated with Musa. Wa Isa Ruhullah. And Isa is Ruhullah. However, wa ana Habibullahi wa la fakhar. And I am the beloved of Allah, and I say this without an iota of pride. Let me tell you, liwa'ul hamdi biyadi yawm al-qiyamah. The banner will be in my hands on the day of qiyamah. Kullun nasi tahta liwa'i. Adam and his progeny till qiyamah will stand under my banner. Ana awwalu man yuharriku bab al-jannah. The first to knock the door of jannah will be me. Fayuftah li, it will be opened up for me and I will enter first. And let me also tell you, I say this without pride. No prophet can put foot into Jannah until I do not enter. So the first quality of the beloved servants of Allah is humbleness. Ulama refer to humbleness as Ummul Mahasin, the mother of all good. And coupled with that, in the same breath and in the same vein, the first quality of people whom Allah dislike and is the enemies of Allah are those that have pride, arrogance and haughtiness. Sayyidina Musa communicated with Allah, Man abghadu khalqik. Oh Allah, tell me, who is the most wicked in your creation? Who is the most wretched in your creation? Allah says, the one who has four evil qualities. Man takabbara qalbuhu, wa ghaludha lisanuhu, wa da'ufa yaqeenuhu, wa bakhilat yaduhu. The one who has pride in his heart. Just as the abode of taqwa is the heart. Nabi alayhi salam said, At-taqwa hahuna wa ashara ila sadrihi thalata marrat. That the abode of fearing Allah is the heart, which is then manifested by the organs. In the same way, the abode of pride is in the heart. The one who has pride in his heart, who is arrogant with his tongue, who is arrogant with his tongue. Brothers, let me seize the opportunity. Few months ago, one person working in our community, working for some affluent family. What example are we giving to those working under our employment? He came to me crying here. Wallah, I don't have words to express. He says, Maulana, I'm a revert. I'm working in this particular family. I'm desperate for the job. The people for whom I'm working, their children come to your madrasa. They speak to me with such arrogance, my heart cries. I have just come to ask you from time to time when you advise the children, teach them respect to speak to those that are senior to them. The one who is arrogant in his tongue, who has weak conviction and who mises with his wealth. That is the most evil in the eyes of Allah. The hadith of Asma bint Umays, Nabi alayhi salam said, بِئْسَ الْعَبْدُ عَبْدٌ تَخَيَّلَ وَاخْتَالَ وَنَسِيَ الْكَبِيرَ الْمُتَعَالَ. Evil indeed is that servant who displays pride and forgets that pride is the garment of Allah. بِئْسَ الْعَبْدُ عَبْدٌ تَجَبَّرَ وَاعْتَدَى وَنَسِيَ الْجَبَّارَ الْأَعْلَى. Evil indeed is that man who displays arrogance and might and forgets that the Almighty is Allah. بِئْسَ الْعَبْدُ عَبْدٌ سَهَى وَلَهَى وَنَسِيَ الْمَقَابِرَ وَالْبِلَى. Evil indeed is that servant who lives a life heedless and oblivious and forgets the grave and its loneliness. بِئْسَ الْعَبْدُ عَبْدٌ عَتَى وَتَغَى وَنَسِيَ الْمُبْتَدَى وَالْمُنْتَهَى. Evil indeed is that servant who rebels and forgets his beginning and his ending. بِئْسَ الْعَبْدُ عَبْدُ طَمْعٍ يَقُودُهُ. Evil indeed is that servant who is driven by greed, and equally evil is that servant who is driven by lust. What are the words of Nabi alayhi salam? What is the definition of pride? My Nabi said, La yadkhulu al-jannah. He will never enter Jannah. Man kana fi qalbihi mithqalu dharratin min kibrin. In whose heart there is an iota of pride. In whose heart there is an iota of pride. Sahaba asked, O Nabi of Allah, I am a person, I'm very meticulous about my dressing. I love my clothes to be neat, my shoes to be neat. وَشِرَاكُ نَعْلِي جَدِيدٍ. In fact, I'm so meticulous, I even want my shoelace to be neat. Is this also pride? Nabi alayhi salam said, no. Let me then set the records correct and define pride. إِنَّ اللَّهَ جَمِيلٌ يُحِبُّ الْجَمَالِ. Allah is beautiful and Allah loves beauty. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ أَن يَرَى أَثَرَ نِعْمَتِهِ عَلَىٰ عَبْدِهِ. Allah loves to see that a person expresses the bounties of Allah upon him. You gave someone a gift, if he uses it, it brings joy to you, he has put it into good use. Allah loves to see that you express the ni'mats of Allah. There is not pride, O my sahabi. Let me tell you what is pride. Al-kibru batru al-haqqi wa ghamtu al-nas. Pride in essence is to consider others inferior. The automatic result of which is you have a perception of yourself and you create an opinion of yourself that I am superior. And وَبَطْرُ الْحَقِّ to deny truth. That is the definition of pride. Now as I mentioned, that when a person has the perception that others are inferior and I am superior, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu said, إِنَّ أَخْوَفَ مَا أَخَافُ عَلَيْكُمْ. The thing I fear the most for you is when you become obsessed with yourself. When you walk around with an attitude and you walk around with an opinion about yourself. وَمَنْ قَالَ أَنَا عَالِمٌ فَهُوَ جَاهِلٌ. The one who says I'm learned, Sayyidina Umar says he's ignorant. وَمَنْ قَالَ أَنَا فِي الْجَنَّةِ فَهُوَ فِي النَّارِ. The one that says I'm in paradise, he is in hell. Someone came to my mother Aisha radiallahu anha. Subhanallah, what words of wisdom Allah inspired on the tongue of the mother of this entire ummah. This sahabi asked Aisha radiallahu anha, مَتَى أَعْلَمْ أَنِّي مُحْسِنٌ. Oh my mother, can you tell me, when will I know that I'm a good person? إِذَا عَلِمْتَ أَنَّكَ مُسِي. She says, as long as you consider yourself to be evil. وَمَتَى أَعْلَمْ أَنِّي مُسِي. When do I know that I'm an evil person? As long as I consider myself to be a good person. Nabi alayhi salam said in the riwayat of Bazaar, لو لم تذنبوا لخشيت عليكم ما هو أكبر منه. O my Sahaba, if you were not to sin, I feared that you would have been grabbed by a sin greater than all sins. And that is pride and obsession over the fact that you're sinless. Al-ujbu, pride will enter into you that I am sinless. What comes in this particular quotation? One person, he made ibadat of Allah for 70 years. This perception, this attitude about oneself. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu says, salvation lies in two things, and destruction lies also in two things. The two things in which salvation lies, at-taqwa wa niyyah, fearing Allah and having noble endeavors. Whenever you interact with anyone, keep your intention clean. Don't have ulterior motive. Noble endeavors and taqwa. And in two things there are destruction. One is despondency. We find currently the aim of the media is to advocate despondency to the entire Muslim ummah, to make them despair. A believer never despairs of the mercy of Allah. Sayyidina Yaqub is separated from his son Yusuf for a period of 80 years. He cries to Allah and he loses his sight. He's making dua to Allah, oh Allah, return my Yusuf. In the process, he loses his second son, Binyamin. You're making dua that this tunnel must come to an end, but it's becoming darker. You're asking Allah for the rain to stop, but it's pouring. One after the other, but a Nabi never despairs. He makes dua to Allah to return the second son, he loses the third son. But what is the spirit of a Nabi? Ya bani yadhhabu fatahassasu min Yusuf wa akhihi wa la tayasu min rawhillah. You're making dua to Allah to cure you from cancer. Doctors now detect a different illness into you. A believer is one that never despairs. He says, oh my sons, those of you that are remaining, go and look for Yusuf and look for my other sons also, and don't despair from the mercy of Allah. It is only the disbelievers that despair. So destruction lies in despair. Wal i'ajab, and having an opinion about yourself, having an attitude that I am someone. Brothers, the world has become so desperate for fame and recognition that people are excelling in evil to be on record. The fattest man in the world. Just to be on record. People are going on hunger strike to gain world sympathy that a human by this name existed. The longest nails in the world. Are these things just for fame? The world has become so desperate to be recognized that I'm also a human that is existing. You haven't greeted me? The Nabi of Allah says, Al-Badi'u bis-salami bari'a min al-kibri. The one who greets first and doesn't wait to be greeted, he is free from pride. There are so many qualities. We learn from the hadith, the one who drops his trousers below his ankle, he is a proud man. Now let me clear this particular hadith. There are certain ahadith where the Nabi of Allah says, whoever drops his trouser below his ankle out of pride will go to Jahannam. Many people argue the fact that, no, I am not doing it out of pride. There is no human whom we can definitely say was free from pride other than the Nabi of Allah. Yet not once in his entire life he dropped any trouser below his ankle. He, with certainty we can say the Nabi of Allah had no pride. Yet he never ever dropped his trouser below his ankle. It is just not at the time of salah. Ma asfala min al-ka'bain fa fi an-nar. Whatever goes beyond that ankle is in Jahannam, that person and whatever else is with him. So what did the Nabi of Allah say? As I was saying, people are desperate for fame. In the same breath, the Nabi of Allah has praised certain people who keep themselves silent, hidden. Nobody knows about them. Nabi alayhi salam says, there are some servants of Allah. That if that man comes to your door, inna min ibadillah, mallaw ata baba ahadikum, he comes to your door, you will look at that man's condition, you will not even give him a 20 cent. These are the words of Nabi alayhi salam. Ajulat maniyatuhu, he lives a short life. Qallat bawaki, at his death, very few people come and mourn. In ghabu lam yuftaqadu, when he's absent from your function, you don't look for him. In hadaru lam yuqarrabu, when he comes, nobody salutes him or gives him additional hospitality. Akfiyaun fi dunya, when he speaks, nobody listens. In khatabu lam yunkihu, when he proposes, nobody accepts his proposal. Very few know him by his name, but I swear by my Allah, ma'rufuna fi sama, every angel knows that man by his name. Oh my Sahaba, he knocks your door, you slam the door. But if that man has left his hands, lo aqsama ala Allahi la abarra, whatever qasam he takes, Allah will make it happen on his qasam. If he has to lift his hands once, Allah will give him Jannatul Firdaus. Sayyidina Abu Zar walks by, Nabi alayhi salam is sitting with Jibreel in the form of Dihya Kalbi. So he doesn't recognize that this is Jibreel. Jibreel tells Nabi alayhi salam, isn't that your companion Abu Zar? لو سلم علينا لرددنا عليه. If he had to greet me, I would have answered his greetings. So Nabi alayhi salam said, oh Jibreel, you know my companions by their name? Jibreel said, وَالَّذِي بَعَثَكَ بِالْحَقِّ نَبِيًّا. Oh Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let me tell you, I swear by that Allah who has sent you as a prophet, Abu Zar is more famous in the skies than the earth. Abu Zar is more famous in the skies than the earth. So pride is, Nabi alayhi salam said, the one that has an iota of pride will never enter into Jannah. Why? The hadith explains that when a man has pride, then this will become an obstacle to all avenues of good. By way of example, the Nabi of Allah says, the proud man will never greet. He'll wait to be greeted. People that say, no, nobody greets. Why don't you greet yourself? And everybody will respond. The problem is you are waiting for people to greet you. This is the problem. Now a proud man will never greet. Number two, Nabi alayhi salam says, ask for forgiveness and Jannah is yours. A proud man will never apologize. It's below his dignity to ask. It's below his dignity to go and apologize. Number three, visit the sick. A proud man will never take out time to visit his employee, to visit those that are poorer than him. It's below his dignity. Hence, in essence, it is one sin, but it is Ummul Amrad, it is the mother of all evils. There are various types of pride. One is pride against Allah. Was not the first crime committed in this universe the quality of pride? When Allah told Shaitan, prostrate to Adam, He said, خَلَقْتَنِي مِن نَارٍ وَخَلَقْتَهُ مِن طِينٍ. But then am I not superior? I was created from fire. He was created from sand. I am superior and he is inferior. Allah speaks about the pride of the kuffar. وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ لَا يَرْجُونَ لِقَاءَنَا لَوْلَا أُنزِلَ عَلَيْنَا الْمَلَائِكَةُ أَوْ نَرَى رَبَّنَا. The kuffar made a request that we want to see Allah with our naked eye. لَقَدْ اسْتَكْبَرُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah says, what pride have they displayed? The second level of pride is pride against the prophets. When Sayyidina Musa, and that is what Nabi alayhi salam said, denial of truth is pride. You're having an elaborate function for your daughter's occasion. One humble man came to you and said, brother, it is your money, it is your daughter. But you know what? The Nabi of Allah told you, you mustn't be so elaborate. So you turn around and you snub him and you say, well, it's not your money, it's not your daughter. Are you jealous that you can't own what I have? The Nabi of Allah says, you are proud, there's no Jannah for you. That denying the truth, that is pride. Even if you say it in a humble tone, it is pride. So denying the truth, what did they say? لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ عَلَىٰ رَجُلٍ مِّنَ الْقَرِيَتَيْنِ عَظِيمٍ. That the Quran shouldn't be revealed on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It should be revealed on Abu Mas'ud Thaqafi or Walid ibn Mughira. This was the pride they displayed. أَهَٰؤُلَاءِ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ بِنْبَيْنِنَا. Is this the so-called fortunate people amongst us? That is the second level of pride. When Nabi alayhi salam told the kuffar that come and sit in my gathering, what comment did they make? كَيْفَ نَجْلِسُ عِنْدَكْ وَعِنْدَكَ هَؤُلَىٰ. How can we sit with you when you have these poor people with you? We can't sit with you. Sayyidina Sulaiman, one of the greatest things to his being accepted in the court of Allah, daily is to take our time and sit with the poor. Daily is to take our time and sit with the poor. Salman Farsi becomes the governor of Medina. Someone mistook him to be a laborer. He said, my brother, will you help me? He says, no problem. He put the load on his shoulders and he started walking. As he enters into the city, people say, Amirul Mu'mineen, Amirul Mu'mineen. The man who gave him the task, he opened up his eyes. He says, Ya Allah, who have I burdened here? That's the time he realized he was Amirul Mu'mineen. He said, lifelong, I caught my ears. I will never task anyone. Such a great man, the governor of Medina, took my load and went. This was the humble nature of both Sahaba and Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ulama have written there are few reasons why pride comes into a person. Number one, pride comes into a person out of knowledge. Each man understands his vulnerability, be it knowledge, be it skills, be it competence. You know, like in English they say fame. If you can't manage it, it becomes a flame and it burns the very same person. You see the celebrities of the world, they come into the limelight, the world salutes them, the youth flock towards them, and then they cannot manage that fame at an early age. They start womanizing, they start taking drugs, they cannot control themselves. Subhanallah, the Nabi of Allah, Allah crowns him with prophethood. He enters into Makkah. My respected father always tells us, he always advises us, until now he cautions me. When man assumes authority, that is very dangerous. Authority, you take a simple man in an ordinary job, sitting behind the counter in a post office, what honorable position is that? But he is behind the counter. He is now pulling the shots. He now dictates. So authority, the Nabi of Allah enters as the conqueror of Makkah. Riwayat suggests he humbled himself so much that his chin was touching his chest. He enters there unlike, you know, with pomp, with might, with honor and dignity. So the first reason is out of knowledge. Nabi alayhi salam has prophesied, a time will come, people will read the Quran and they will say, Man aqra'u minna, who can be more learned than me? That is the first reason of pride. The second reason of pride is, out of piety, a person does certain good action, he becomes proud about the whole thing. Nabi alayhi salam said, when you hear someone saying halak an-nas, that people are useless and hopeless, then remember he is the worst of them all. He is the most hopeless amongst them all. That is why we have been constantly exhorted that we spend our health and our wealth in the time of Allah, in the path of Allah. If a man only spends his wealth, pride will come into him. I sponsored a masjid here. I put up a well here. I sent 5 people for hajj. That is pride. And if a man will only come on the sponsorship of others, greed will come into him. I'm ready, you sponsor me. You sponsor me, and that is why the Quran says, "Jahadu bi amwalihim." The balance between the two is your own health and your wealth. That is the time no pride will come. That is the second reason, out of piety. Pride comes into a person that I have done so much. One man worshipped Allah for 70 years in Bani Israel. After that he made dua to Allah. Allah did not accept his dua. فَأَقْبَلَ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ He admonished himself and he says, you know what? You are incapable, you are incompetent. Otherwise Allah would have accepted your dua. And he started reprimanding himself. Allah sent an angel to tell this person, إِنَّ سَاعَتَكَ الَّتِي إِزْدَرَيْتَ نَفْسَكَ That moment where you condemned yourself was better than your 70 years of ibadat. That is what Allah wants. The third reason of pride is because of wealth. A man becomes proud. Subhanallah, look at the wealth I have. Look at the car I drive. Allah speaks about 2 brothers in Bani Israel who met after years. The father died. They inherited the legacy. One invested his money in akhirat. The other one invested it in the world. He developed. He expanded. He went far. He had a wonderful house, car, everything. So one day he meets his brother. قال له صاحبه وهو يحاوره أن يفاخره أنا أكثر منك مالا وأعز نفرا. He takes his brother, he says, let me show you my house, let me show you my garden. He shows him everything he has. The brother is silent. He just observes. Then he says, look at my garden, look at my orchards. You gave in charity. Well, that's the consequences of your wealth. The brother, the pious brother, after listening to the entire discussion, he said, oh my brother, I wish you well in your wealth. I have no problem. I don't own a car. MashaAllah, you own wonderful cars. Your children live in such an affluent life. I don't have a problem with your wealth, but I have a major problem with your attitude. Let me tell you, if you are making this the grounds of honor, very soon you will see, Allah will grant me a better garden than yours. And I'm afraid Allah will send a divine torment. The very next day, Allah Ta'ala send a divine torment and reduce this thing to ruins. That he got up in the morning saying, Ya laytani lam ushrik bi rabbi ahada. I wish I had never ascribed partners with Allah. Allah took everything away from me. The fourth reason for pride is out of beauty. Imam Ghazali has written in Ihya'ul Ulumuddin, this generally happens in women. You find women say, she's so dirty, she couldn't even say I look nice. Yeah, subhanAllah. Is she waiting for comments? Waiting for someone to praise her? Wallahu Akbar, Aisha radiallahu anha puts on a beautiful garment. Her father Abu Bakr comes by. As any woman, she admires herself. Abu Bakr tells her, مَا تَنْذُرِينَ يَا عَيْشَ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَيْسَ بِنَاظِرٍ إِلَيْكَ Oh my daughter Fatih, oh my daughter Aisha, what are you admiring? Because Allah is not admiring you. Why my father? Don't you know my daughter when you dress that? And you consider yourself superior and others inferior. Allah abandons you till you abandon that pride. She took out that garment and she gave it in charity. She then became Aisha Siddiqa. The riwayat of Bukhari, food for thought for the youth. Nabi alayhi salam says, Bainama rajulun, one man was walking, yamshi, tu'jibuhu nafsuhu, impressed by himself. And murajjilun ra'sahu, he had his hair combed beautifully. Yakhtalu fi mashiyatihi, arrogant in his walk. You find so many of the youth, they drive in a courtesy BM and they show off. Not even his own car. It belongs to the garage, but the man is flashing up with his car. What an arrogant walk. It doesn't even belong to him. What did the Nabi of Allah say? What an arrogant, what an attitude. He takes out his cigarette in front of you. You look at him, you know, to tell him. He says, look at that guy. He's looking at me as if his son doesn't smoke. Look at that top. He's taking me blind. What an attitude, brothers. You see it happening. Huh? Nabi alayhi salam says, from the arsh of Allah, Allah looked at him down. Allah said, told the earth to split. My Nabi said, فَهُوَ يَتَجَلْجَلُ فِيهَا إِلَىٰ يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ He will sink in the earth till the day of Qiyamah. I haven't got time. The next reason for pride, the Nabi of Allah says, is strength. The ulama have written strength. What did the Shun of Ad say? مَنْ أَشَدُّ مِنَّا قُوَّةً Who is stronger than us? You know, you find these people lifting weights and that. I find it to be a very strange passion. But I respect the diversity of passions that people have. And, you know, whatever it is. For me, brothers, wallah, strength is if you can lower your gaze when a semi-nude woman walks by. There is strength in the eyes of Allah. If you can flip the blanket and respond to the Lord in the early parts of the morning, قَلِيلًا كَانُوا قَلِيلًا مِنَ اللَّيْلِ يَهْجَعُونَ Then you're a strong man. But I don't have a problem with your passion. I have a problem with your sleeveless vest. The muscles that are protruding. Why do you have to wear a sleeveless vest? The Quran says, أَوَلَمْ يَرَوْا أَنَّ اللَّهَ الَّذِي خَلَقَهُمْ هُوَ أَشَدُّ مِنْهُمْ قُوَّةً. Don't they realize the one who gave them strength is stronger than them? We make dua to the Almighty Allah. Scholars have written to break pride, number one, constantly remember of your sins. Really, brothers, often you go for a program, person stands and introduces you. I always say that man is saying what he's saying because he doesn't know the other half of me. If he knows the other half, he would have never dared saying what he is saying. That dark life of me, you wouldn't have taken your time to come and listen to me. Each man knows he's dark. He's praising you because he doesn't know the other half of you. That is the kindness of Allah that he has veiled us. So constantly look at your sins. Secondly, regard yourself incapable of what Allah has given you. Allah, I don't deserve this fame. Allah, I don't deserve this wealth. Allah, I'm a hopeless, useless, helpless, feeble servant. Allah, these children, this wealth, it is only your sheer mercy. We make dua to the Almighty Allah, He free our hearts from pride and arrogance and make us humble servants of Allah Ta'ala. That verily the Nabi of Allah says, whoever will display humbleness, Allah will elevate him to the skies, and whoever will display pride, Allah will drop him beneath the earth. Allah inspire us all. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah.